Friends, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Praise God. That's how we start. Welcome to Calvary Baptist Church. Happy Easter to you and to your family. Thank you for being here. If you're a guest with us today, we welcome you. Thank you for being a part of this service. You'll find a card similar to this somewhere close to you. If you're a guest with us, would you take a few minutes as the service progresses along? Fill that card out. You can place it in the offering plate. You can give it to us later sometime in the service. We just want to know that you were worshiping with us today. It means a lot that you would join us today. We're glad that you're here. Thank you for being a part of this service. You are in for a blessing this morning. I've had the opportunity for the last few weeks to be able to listen to our choir and those that God has brought together to lead and to do the technical part. And every single time that I've had the blessing of hearing what you're about to hear, it has blessed and touched my heart. It's going to bless and touch your heart today. Our Savior will be honored. His name will be lifted up. And together we will praise the Lord. Some of these songs you're going to recognize, and you're really going to disappoint me if on those that you recognize, you don't say or sing the songs along with the choir, because some of them you will. It is a beautiful arrangement meant to do one thing and one thing only, and it's to praise our Lord. Welcome. We have gathered together today just to praise the Lord. Remember the words of the doxology? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Our Father, our hearts are full of praise and gratitude because while we were still estranged from you, by our choices and rebellion, you loved us and you built a human bridge to us with the life of your very own Son. Thank you that we could never drift from your presence, that if we ride on the morning wind to the furthest ocean, even there your hand will guide us and your strength will support us. Thank you for your persistent love. Thank you for the family of God who lifts us up when we fall, encourages us when we're weak, and rejoices when we conquer. Thank you for the earth and nature and the beauty that reminds us of your awesome creativity and our responsibility to protect it. Thank you for children who keep wonder and hope in our lives. Thank you for your word, the Bible. It speaks fresh every morning, living truth and ageless wisdom. It is a light to the path in a dark world. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Our hearts are so full of praise for what you have done.
for he has won a mighty victory by his power and holiness. He has announced his victory to every nation by fulfilling his promise to be kind to Israel. The whole earth has seen God's salvation of his people. That is why the earth breaks out in praise and sings to God for utter joy. Join us. Sing your praises accompanied by music from the heart. Tell everyone about the amazing things he does. Praise him with horns. Praise him with cymbals. Yes, with loud clanging cymbals.
Make a joyful symphony before the Lord. Let the whole earth and all those living on it shout, glory to the Lord.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Well, actually, I'm a tax collector. He came to my house for dinner one day. We talked for a while. Well, I don't know what happened to me, but I ended up giving half of everything I owned to poor people. And to those who I cheated, I gave back four times the amount I took. There's just something about him.
Thank you. Bethlehem. He was born there, I believe, I believe. Galilee, Jesus walked there, I believe, I believe. Gethsemane, my Savior prayed there. On Calvary, He died alone. But the tomb, He left there, I believe, I believe.
Bethlehem, He was born there, but there was nothing sacred about that manger in Bethlehem. Jesus could have been born in the best hotel room in all the city had it been left open for Him. But it wasn't, and He isn't cushy, and He still isn't. He moves only in the places that we vacate for Him. There was room that night only in the stable, so that's where He was born.
Galilee, Jesus walked there, I believe. I believe.
Jesus walked with common men, but there was nothing common about His words. They upset every comfortable ethic. He upset judicial systems when He said, love those that hate you. He upset patterns of religion by declaring that real temples of worship were in the hearts of believers. He refused to discuss laws and rules governing people's actions, but He zeroed in on their thoughts and their attitudes instead. If Christ had been a philosopher, they could have debated Him. Had He been a warrior, they could have fought Him. Had He been a religionist, they could have ignored Him as an eccentric. But Christ was love. Man, what do you do with that?
Yes, everybody.
In those dark hours, He cried in desperation, Father, if it be Your will, let this cup pass from me. But it wasn't God's will, and He died alone. But the tomb Jesus left there, I believe. God could have had Jesus resurrected right from the cross, but instead He arranged a full burial, a tomb, even a Roman seal. But after 3 days conquering death, Christ came out alive, free, leaving for all the world to see that He could. And now He reigns. He reigns forever. I believe. Oh, Alleluia. I do believe, what a powerful statement. For thousands of years, people have staked their very lives on this belief that Jesus Christ is real. Why? Because it gives their life meaning. And today, it's exactly the same. Jesus Christ in a life does make a difference. He's the source of a meaningful and purposeful life. Where there's dissonance, He makes music. Yeah, He's the source of music.
That song goes on. Happy Easter to all of you. As we would say in Brazil in Portuguese, Feliz Páscoa. Happy Passover. It's Passover time. Well, we were singing about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And now it's testimony time. Sharing what God has done through Jesus and how it has affected our lives. Beth was born in a fine Christian home. At the age of 5, she accepted Jesus as Savior and Lord. Her father was a Baptist pastor. I grew up in a different home, fine Christian home. My father was a deacon in the Baptist church. I accepted Jesus when I was 11 years of age. We were in different cities, different churches, but we got together in Baptist youth work in our state and also at youth rallies. After a time of study at the Bible school, at the university, also at seminary, we got married. And it was in our last year at seminary that we got married, and we sought together the will of God as to what He would have us do. What really helped us was Romans 12:1-2, about knowing that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. And we felt that God was calling us to be missionaries in Brazil, which He allowed us to do for 37 years, to God be the glory. God gave us wonderful ministry there. Beth mainly involved in hospital ministry as a couple, pastor, pastor's wife, church planting, evangelism, also work at the seminary teaching, and also as chaplain of the seminary. So God gave wonderful opportunities by His grace. But there was a moment in our lives when we were wondering if our time would be cut short. Beth was coming home from the bookstore, evangelical bookstore, in our big city of Porto Alegre, about 1,200,000. And as she was leaving the bookstore, she got caught in a riot, a political racial riot, something rare to happen. But as people were running to get away from the riot, she was doing the same, and someone pushed her, and she fell, and she broke her hip. But as a result of that, God directed that a Bible study begin in our home. As we got to know the neighbors more and they got to know us. So praise God to that. And that Bible study continues to this day. But after that first surgery, Beth still had 4 more hip surgeries on that same hip. And you got involved in some of that recovery time as she was here in Longview. So God is blessed. God allowed us with our children, 3 children, to participate with this in ministry. But you know what? The more that we prayed as a couple and as individuals, the more that we read the Bible as a couple and as individuals, the more that we shared Jesus with others, Jesus became that much more real to us. The longer I serve, the sweeter He grows.
More love He bestows each day. I fell under heavy conviction of God's Spirit and went to my youth pastor and had him lead me through the Lord's Prayer. On the playground, I received Christ as my Savior. He saved me from my sins. Growing up as a teenager, I still struggled with life because I didn't really know how to live it. I chose to live it for myself. And nearing the age of 20, I really was going down the wrong roads, I would say, like a prodigal son wandering in darkness. So at the age of 21, outside in my pickup truck, after coming out of a bar, I realized that living for myself was living for the devil, because I thought I had control of this life. And at that time, in my pickup truck, I just realized I lost control of my life to a substance called alcohol. And in that pickup truck, under strong conviction, I chose and surrendered to Jesus Christ as the Lord of my life. And what a difference He has made ever since then. Praise Him.
It was a life filled with endless desperation, without hope.
Calvary, I remember when I was a kid and my parents taught me that if I really wanted something, I just need to put my mind to it and, you know, work hard and you'll succeed. I was living the American dream. I went to college on a football scholarship. Married my high school sweetheart, got a degree in engineering, got my first real paying job working on those real big drag lines, you know, the move dirt and everything. Had four great kids, became a deacon in the church, Sunday school teacher, you know, it was great. I was saved when I was 8 years old. But now being older, you know, I was very well educated in the church, you know, stuff in the church and world and stuff like that. I started thinking about that time at 8 years old. I mean, now that I studied the Bible, man, I could tell you all sorts of stuff, and don't get me started on Revelation. But how could I have been saved then with the little I knew then compared to what I know now? I just couldn't figure it out. It just didn't make any sense. You know, I was a pretty smart 8-year-old, but not that smart. But then I got the scripture that said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him." You know, that was Jesus talking. He did not say you had to be smart or handsome or any of that kind of stuff. He just said you had to believe in him. Pure and simple, isn't it? Kind of easy. You know, nothing else counted except that I believe in Jesus. I believed in Jesus then, and I believe in Jesus now. And you can too.
Thank you.
history, changing lives, has been his business. He's changed the rich, he's changed the poor. He's changed the high and mighty, and he's changed the meek. He changed my life. Maybe he's changed yours. But if he hasn't, it can happen for you right now. And today, right where you are, right here, you know something. If you'll just let him, he will.
Thank you.
stop Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection from happening. Herod, you remember when Jesus was born? Herod was the paranoid ruler that said he would rather kill all babies in the area of Bethlehem, all baby boys 2 years and younger, to keep Jesus from coming and living and dying on the cross. When did you start believing it? Satan tried to stop it. You remember when Jesus was in the wilderness praying and he was being tempted? Satan took Jesus at one point to the top of the highest mountain and he showed him the kingdom of the world and he said, bow down to me and I'll give you all of this. Satan wanted to stop our chance of believing this. Judas. Remember Judas the betrayer? The Bible tells us in Luke 23 that Satan entered into Judas and he was one of the 12, and Judas went to the chief priests and the officers of the temple guard and he discussed with them how he could betray Jesus. Trying to stop our chance of believing this, that he lived and died on the cross and that he did it for us. Simon Peter, well, he was the brave defender. You remember in the Garden of Gethsemane? Simon Peter drew his sword. He didn't even know how to use a sword, and he tried to cut one of the guards' heads off, and he missed, and he cut his ear off. Simon Peter tried to stop this. Pontius Pilate and his wife tried to stop this. Over and over, Pontius Pilate said, I find nothing wrong with this man. Innocent of all crimes. And Pontius Pilate's wife came to him. Luke records it. And she says to her husband, she said, have nothing to do with this man. He's innocent. I've had a bad dream about him all day long. Many tried to stop your chance to believe. When did you start to believe? Trey McKee came walking up to me this morning. He gave my wife a quarter to give to me. It happens to be a 1972 quarter. Because Trey knows that when he gives me a 1972 quarter, I'm going to go tell somebody that I believe. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for my sins. He did it for me in 72. That's when I believed it. When did you believe it? When did you believe that Jesus died on the cross for you? Would you bow your heads? Today, if you've never, ever told Jesus that you believe that he died on the cross for you, and that he was buried in a tomb, and that he was raised on that third day, today you can believe. Today can be your day of salvation, like it was for me when I was 8, Trey, when he realized he needed God in his life. Dick and Beth, when they answered the call, they believed and served. And Travis believed and served. Today can be your day. The Bible says in Romans 10, 9 and 10, that if you believe in your heart that Jesus was God's Son, and you confess it, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. So right where you are, you can say, Jesus, I believe. I believe that you are God's Son. I believe that you died for me. Jesus, come into my heart. Father, I pray today that if someone prayed that prayer, a prayer that says they believe for the first time today, I thank you that that person right now, right this minute, today, has had their chapel life changed. Like the fisherman that spoke and said Jesus changed his life. Like the tax collector that spoke and said that Jesus had changed his life. Like the woman at the well that spoke and said Jesus changed thank you that today you changed that person's life. Father, I thank you for that. I thank you today, God, that you offer us a chance this Easter Resurrection Sunday. You offer us a chance right now to recommit our lives to you. To not just say that we believe, but to commit to live like we believe. So I pray for each of us today that this Easter will be a starting over for us. Thank you that you forgive us. And you give us a chance to make a new start. Lord, I pray that if there's some of us today that need to just start over, thank you that you give us that privilege and that opportunity today. Father, thank you that today, together, we believe that Jesus is alive. And because he lives, we can face tomorrow. Because he lives, we can face everything that this world has to offer. I thank you that today there's not a person in here that has a problem that's too big for you. Because Jesus Christ lives, thank you that they can face that with you. Thank you that there's not a health concern, that there's not a relationship that's too far gone. Thank you that there's not a situation that's too big for you to step in and to bring that person right back where you want them to be. Father, we commit today, this Easter Sunday, this Resurrection Sunday, we commit that you are God and that your Son, Jesus Christ, is alive. He is risen. He is risen indeed. We thank you. We praise you. We glorify in your name. I thank you for it all, and I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
If today someone blessed your heart, maybe it was someone doing the technical part of the cantata today. Maybe it was someone that was running sound. Maybe it was someone that was gifted in the ability to be able to lead. Or maybe it was someone that just opened their mouth and blessed you with the beautiful gift of music. Would you let all of them, would you join me in letting them know? Let's give God a hand. Friend, it's been good to be in the house of the Lord with you. I invite you to stand with me, if you would. I want to read a benediction. We're going to be dismissed. This benediction we read often here, and if you're a guest with us today, I do want you to come back. Come back and worship with us another time. But I want to read a benediction to you. It is our closing statement of faith in what God has promised to do. Before I read it, one more time, friends, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Then may the Lord bless you. May he protect you. May the Lord smile on you. May he be gracious to you. And may the Lord show you his favor. And may he give you his peace. And all God's people said,
amen.
God bless you. We are dismissed.